Hey, kids. Come on down. It's on this time. Oh, my goodness. Big old gray pair. Itty bitties. I'm so excited. Are you okay today? Nobody's talking to me. I know I'm nervous, right? Yes, Joshua, I'm nervous. So, what is this I have on my head? Cool, it's your braids. And what is it for? What does it do for me, though? Shows that I like the team. Yeah, that's not what I'm looking for. What else does it do? Yeah, text me from what? Sunlight, right. Okay, so how many of y'all have like maybe a burglar alarm, or since we're getting ready to have a shooting class or whatever, have guns at home or tasers or whatever, pepper spray, that kind of thing. For me, I have to have guns for snakes. I just don't do snakes anymore. They have to die. So that's called what? Protection, right? So this hat I wear when I walk. If you go up and down by the curves and everywhere, you'll see me walking with my hat on to keep the sun out of my face for protection. It's always a good time or a good feeling to know that you're safe, okay? Some people have security systems, alarms, or even bodyguards. Do y'all have a bodyguard? Who's your bodyguard? Well, yeah, God, but your mom and dad right now, because y'all are itty-bitties, right? When you get bigger, they still need to be guarded. But anyway, who doesn't want to feel safe and secure? So there is a way you can always feel safe and secure. How would that happen? How can you always feel like you're safe? Anybody? How? Your brain, yeah. But I mean, there are some instructions, though, that you've got to follow, right? What are some instructions that you need to follow to make sure that you are always safe? How about what the Lord tells you, right? Y'all ever get the feeling that you're somewhere where you're not supposed to be and you need to get away from there? Or there's this friend of yours that's doing something that you really don't think he should be doing or she should be doing, and you think you need to go on and go back in the golf playground or get away from that person? That's God protecting you from bad things. I don't know, growing up, I probably would be dead if the Lord had not intervened many times with all the traveling I did. You know, he always protects us when we're not even thinking about it. So you always have to listen, okay? That means that you've got to know what God wants you to do. And it's kind of like when you had to be nice to your teacher, even though she's just made you really mad, right? Right? Uh-huh. Or, you know, when your mom and dad really make you really mad, come on now, I know they do, right? So you have to stop and listen to that. So this, who knows what this is? Right now, we all need it because my nose is running. Okay, so see this blanket right here? Sorry, it was Tiffany's. That is what God's love is like. It's like a big old warm fuzzy blanket. He's got his protection all over you. So you don't have to worry about the world. You don't have to worry about what's bad in the world going on or what's bad around you going on or and then that kind of thing, because that blanket is a physical reminder that God's protection is always on his children. Okay? Even on little boys, right? Mm-hmm. Little cuties. So, yeah, little bitty cuties. I don't have them. I'm big cuties. Across the ocean right now. So what you need to do is you listen to what God has to say. It could be that very thing that he's telling you that will keep you from from harm. So listen to him and he'll help you live in peace and keep you safe. All who listen to me will live in peace, untroubled by fear or harm. Proverbs 1:33. And I've got a couple of verses here. Psalm 138:7 says, though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the anger of my foes. With your right hand, you save me. And then Isaiah 41:10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Okay, so let's pray. Bow your heads. Lord, I want to listen to you because I love you and I want to be under your protection. Please help me to listen to you and follow your way today. Amen.
I'll represent our church as a whole, and I want just Judy to represent the staff. And the church we really have, this is, last week was his seventh year here. And we meant to do this last week, but since he wasn't here, we couldn't do that. So it works out okay, because this is Pastor Appreciation Month anyway. Judy, do you want to say some things, please?
We just feel so blessed as a staff, and I know y'all do as a church, to have Brother Rocky and Sharon.
Yes.
It's been a wonderful, wonderful 7 years. You know, y'all know how long I've been here, but for the first time, when he came, I had a pastor that I could plan worship with, and I can't tell y'all how wonderful it is. I hope you can tell the difference. It's absolutely wonderful, and we just love y'all, and thank God for you every day. And I almost didn't cry.
Okay, wait a minute. Yeah. All right. Now this is a card from this is from the church as a whole. And I'll let Miss Judy present
these
other cards.
There's two boxes on. There's a box on either side of these. This pretty arrangement down here. The box that says "Give Thanks." It's got cards in it for you and Sharon from people. Oh. They've been bringing cards. They've been hiding them in the choir room because I told them you only come in the choir room when I clean it up and I ask you to come see it. So.
That's what you think.
Oh, I'm going to have to put a camera up. But anyway, the boxes say "Give Thanks" because we are so thankful for y'all.
Yes, we are. We're thankful for you.
Thank you so much.
It's time for applause.
Well, thank you so much. I can't begin to tell you how much you mean to Sharon and me. I've told some of you this privately, and I'll just go ahead and say it out loud. It's a hard thing to match the experience and love and support that I found in my own home church. And it was so strong there that it's been difficult for me through the years, because I couldn't help but compare every place I was to my home church. But Utica Baptist Church has far, far surpassed my experience even there. And that ought to tell you a little bit about how much, Sharon, and I love you and appreciate you. And in the way that you have not forgotten Sharon, even though she hasn't been able to attend in more than 2 years now, how you have not forgotten her, and how you keep praying for her and asking about her, and the little gifts and cards that you send to her, it just means the world to her to know that you still include her in what's going on. And I know that she appreciates that so much. You may not know this, but you know, Sharon did not grow up in a Baptist church. And so when we got married, and we were in our church in Yazoo County, that was her really first experience with a Southern Baptist church. And it was not what I had hoped it would be. But when we came here, your love toward her has just it made it worth hauling all that stuff that we had up there down here. And sometimes I just feel so woefully inadequate to do for you what you need a pastor to be doing. And I feel really guilty sometimes that I can't do a lot of the things that I feel like you need. And so your love and support, in spite of all of that, really, once again, says volumes about you and about who you are. When we first began talking to the Pastor Search Committee, and of course I had met Brother Snell a few times, had talked to him, rarely, but I didn't know who he was, and I knew that he had been here a long time, but I didn't know exactly how long, and Billy Dane told me how long, and they'd been here twice as your pastor, and I thought, well, you know what, that says a whole lot about him, but it also says a lot about the church. That a pastor would not only, having been there a few years and be asked to come back, would actually come back There's been a few places that I would go back to before when I was younger, but some of them I wouldn't even dream of. Thank you, Lord, that part of my life's over. But it did. It spoke a lot about you. It said a lot about you. And I just want you to know how much we love you and how much we appreciate you. And thank you. And I thank the Lord for giving us the opportunity to be here with you. Thank you. Oh, yeah. One more thing. In case you don't hear it at the end of the service, I love you.
Please join with us and turn to hymn 72, Holy Ground. We are standing, so let's stand. Standing in His presence on Holy Ground. We'll sing this through two times.
Let's pray. Father, we're so thankful today that we have that standing upon the finished work of Jesus Christ upon the cross, and His death, His burial, and His resurrection and ascension, and His soon coming again. Father, we're so thankful again for our pastor and Miss Sharon. Father, we just thank you that he followed your call to come here. And Father, I just pray you'll continue to bless them and use them here. Father, help us to be the church that supports him and Miss Sharon and supports your work, Father. I pray now today for those who have lost loved ones, for those families. And Father, we just pray your loving comfort and grace upon them today. And through this, Father, may they know that you love them. And Father, I pray that today, that if there's one here that does not know you today, Father, I pray that you'll call them today with by your grace, by the power of the Spirit today, and that they will come, Father, to know you. Father, we love you and we thank you for loving us. Thank you for all the many blessings that you give us every day. Help us, Father. Help us to be the light that you would have us to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, I do bring you greetings from Baby Central. Jason will be here this afternoon for Kids Choir and Awana. He just wasn't ready to leave them all day yet, but I know that time will be here. But he and Shelby thank everyone for your prayers. Let's turn to 480, Step by Step. We're going to sing this through two times, and we'll turn back just a few pages to 473, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. We'll do all three verses of that.
Dear Lord, love.
That good singing this morning. Please stand for the doxology. Remain standing for the offertory prayer to follow, and we will be doing the Amen at the end.
Praise God from earth, all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures.
Let us pray. Father God, thank you for allowing us to have this day, Father, to come into your house and worship, Father. Thank you for the seasons that are changing, Father, and the opportunity to see your glory in action, Father. Father God, please bless these tithes and offerings. Take them into your storehouse, Father, and send them out where they need to be. In Christ's name we ask. Amen.
2 Corinthians 12:9 says, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." Every ray of hope we shine, every blessing left behind is only by His grace.
Grace alone, which God supplies.
Miss Judy, you did it again. She told me earlier this week about this song, and she says, "Now, it doesn't have anything to do with your sermon." Oh, yes, it does. Oh, yes, it does. Well, I'm going to ask you to turn with me. I know it says in the bulletin, Ruth chapter 1, but I want you to turn first to Genesis 19. Genesis 19, and find the end of that chapter, and then and mark it. You know how we do sometimes. Find Genesis 19 and the end of that chapter, and then mark it, and then go to Ruth. Okay? And Ruth is not hard to find. Remember, it's you've got the five books of Moses, and then you've got Joshua, Judges, Ruth. So it's real easy to find. It only has four chapters. So it'd be easy to overlook it if you're in a hurry, but just take your time and you'll find it. Genesis 19 and then Ruth chapter 1, which is where we will read from in just a few minutes. I read about a guy who felt like he was a colossal failure. It seemed like everything he did, he just couldn't get his life going. it just didn't work for him. And he began to dream about what it would be like to have lots and lots of money. And he tried to figure out a way to get money real fast. And so he decided that he was going to rob a bank. And so he stayed up late every night drawing these plans and sketches and going over all the steps that he would take in robbing the bank. Even wrote out what he would say when he walked in. But then every morning when morning came, he was afraid to follow through. He just chickened out every time. And that went on for many days. He finally decided that he would drive to the bank. So he got up that morning, he drove to the bank. But when he got there, he parked in the parking lot and he sat there for 3 hours. He was afraid to go in. Well, finally, he got up enough courage to follow through with his plans. He got out of the car, he went into the bank. And at the teller's window, he handed the teller his pistol. And he stuck the brown paper bag in her face and said, "Don't stick with me, this is a mess up." Well, it really was. Now, you may never have attempted to rob a bank. I hope not. But have you ever felt like a big mess up? Have you ever felt that because of your past or your family or because of something else that in your life that God could not or would not use you? Or maybe you felt that because you don't have a great deal of education or the right amount of money or the social contacts or membership in a country club that God could not use you. Or perhaps you're sitting here today and you're burdened by something that you did in the past, some act of passion or indiscretion or even willful disobedience and sin. You knew it was wrong when you did it. And you think that because of that, God cannot or will not use you or save you. Now, if you fall into one of those categories, then I want to tell you, folks, that there is good news in this book. There's good news in this book. Today we find that good news in the Old Testament book of Ruth. Now, the Old Testament, you need to understand this. The Old Testament is not complete without the New Testament. And in fact, the New Testament is not complete without the Old Testament. If you were to take out every reference to the Old Testament out of the New Testament, you wouldn't have a whole lot of it left. Either direct quotes or indirect references. And we're totally missing the point if we don't see that. Between us today and the events recorded in the book of Ruth, and in fact all of the Old Testament, stands the cross of Christ. And anything that we see in the Old Testament, we have to view it through the cross in order to see its true meaning. It's all one story. It's not two different stories. It's all one story. For instance, whatever significance the Passover feast may have had for the Hebrew people, it means nothing to us at all unless we see that Christ is our Passover lamb. Whenever we read about the Passover, we must read it with the understanding of what Christ accomplished on the cross in payment for our sins. The Hebrew people had a Passover lamb. And that Passover lamb was a foreshadowing. It pointed toward the ultimate Passover lamb, which is Christ. And we read about that in one of Paul's letters to the Corinthians. And it's the same when we turn to the book of Ruth. Ruth, the person, is probably one of the most loved women in the Bible. Her story has been called one of the most delicate romances in the Bible. It's been said by someone else that the book of Ruth is an amazingly beautiful story told with simplicity and quietness. Now, we don't know who actually wrote the book of Ruth, but we do know that even though it is a beautiful story, and it is a literary gem, it has no eternal significance. It doesn't have any meaning for us today if we will not look through the cross of Christ to see what it was God had in mind. Why is that little tiny four-chapter book in the Bible to start with? Well, I have to stand behind the cross of Christ before I can see the importance of the book of Ruth for my life as a Christian and as a born-again child of God. And whenever I'm tempted, and this is so important to the message today, I hope you hear this next sentence very carefully. Whenever I am tempted to believe that God cannot
or will not use me because of something in my past, I only have to turn to the book of Ruth to find out that that is just not so. There is nothing in my past that will prevent God from using me. There's nothing in your past. It doesn't matter what it is, and I'm going to prove that to you in just a few minutes. There's nothing in your past that will prevent God from using you. Because you see, the author, whoever he may have been, was not just trying to tell a pretty story. He was trying to prove that King David was a descendant of a Moabite woman. Now, more on that in just a minute. Let's read the opening verses of Ruth chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. Would you stand with me in honor of God's word, please? In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a man from Bethlehem in Judah, together with his wife and two sons, went to live for a while in the country of Moab. The man's name was Elimelech, his wife's name Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephratites from Bethlehem, Judah, and they went to Moab and lived there. Now Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. They married Moabite women, one named Orpah and the other Ruth. Now, to kind of put this story together, and we're going to be going through the book of Ruth the next few weeks, but to put this story together, go over, just turn a couple of pages, if you need to find chapter 4, and we're going to start with verse 18. You may have never heard a sermon on these verses ever before, but I want you to catch what we're doing today. Ruth 4, verse 18. This then is the family line of Perez. Perez was the father of Hezron. Hezron the father of Ram. Ram the father of Amminadab. Amminadab the father of Nahshon. Nahshon the father of Salmon. Salmon the father of Boaz. That name familiar? Boaz the father of Obed. Obed the father of Jesse. And Jesse the father of David. Thank you. You may be seated. Now, I want you to notice that as soon as King David is mentioned, as soon as he's mentioned, the book ends. It stops. Now, surely there was a lot more to the story of Ruth and her life with Boaz. It was beautiful and encouraging and so forth, but that's not why the book was written. It was written to show us that Ruth was an ancestor of David. Now, what's so important about that? Well, it wouldn't mean anything to us at all unless, as we've already said, we look at the book of Ruth through the cross of Christ. That way, we're able to see wonderful truths from God's Word that we otherwise would not see at all. They wouldn't make any sense to us at all. We need, and listen to me, folks. That's true of anything that you read in the Old Testament. When you read the Old Testament, you don't just need to see it as a story. You need to see how that story fits into God's overall plan of redemption for mankind. You see? So, what does this mean? And what does it matter to us? Well, I want to show you this. We need to look closely at Ruth. Who was she? What kind of person was she? What kind of past did she have? And why was it important that she was an ancestor of King David? Well, first of all, we know that Ruth was a woman. And you say, well, duh, preacher, I didn't need you to tell me that. No, of course you didn't. But here's why I want to bring this up. The book of Ruth is one of only two books in the entire Bible named after a woman, the other being Esther. She's one of only four women named in the genealogy of Jesus Christ in the New Testament. Now, in that day and age, and in almost every culture, women were not held in very high esteem. There were several women in Scripture who were mentioned simply because they're God-fearing, virtuous women. But women were considered to be inferior to men, so much so that that a girl was considered to be the property of her father. In fact, he could even sell her as a slave to pay off his debts. And when she grew up and married, and almost all of them did, whether they wanted to be or not, she essentially became the property of her husband. So in the eyes of many people in that day, in many different cultures, Ruth had one strike against her. The day she was born, she was a woman. But that wasn't all. Not only was Ruth a woman, but she was a Moabite woman. Now, Moab was the country just east of the Dead Sea, just east of Canaan. And the Moabites had been enemies of the Hebrew people for a long time. And it is certain that the Jews considered it a dishonor, one of those skeletons in the closet, that King David had a Moabitess in his lineage. Now, we find the beginning of the Moabite people when we turn to Genesis chapter 19. And I'm not going to read the whole story there because we have some young ears here present. But you have to read the story of how the beginning of the Moabite people begins in Genesis 19:30 with Lot and his two daughters. Okay, they had a relationship, and then look at verse 36. Both of Lot's daughters became pregnant by their father. The older daughter had a son, and she named him Moab. He is the father of the Moabites to this day. Okay? So that's how they got their start. Not a very proud and noble heritage, but that's the history of the Moabites. That's the kind of background that Ruth had. Then as you move through the Scriptures, the next time that we see the Moabites, the Hebrew people were just about to enter the promised land of Canaan after they had escaped from Egypt. But to get there, they had to go through the place where the Moabites lived. They had to go through the land of Moab. Now, at first, the Moabites showed this kind of a tense politeness to the Hebrews. But when Moses sent word to the king of Moab that they wanted permission, they just wanted permission just to go through the land. We're not going to take anything. We're going to clean up after ourselves. We're just going to move from here to there. And, you know, it's like they just need a right of way to get from here to there. Well, not only did the king refuse that permission, but he sent out an army to attack them. Well, in the battle that ensued, the Moabites were defeated. And Israel, of course, went right straight on through. But while they were in Moab, the king of Moab sent for Balaam to come and curse the Hebrews. That's the story that we're all familiar with about the donkey that spoke. Remember that? The donkey seeing the angel of the Lord standing in the road ahead with his sword drawn, and Balaam struck the donkey to get him to go, hit him three times with a walking stick, and finally the donkey spoke to him. Remember that story? Kind of comical at first, but if you keep in mind, and this is very important, that happened while the king of Moab was trying to have a curse put on the Israelites. I can't beat you one way, I'm going to try to beat you another. So there's not a lot of good relationships, not a lot of good blood between the people of Moab and the people of Israel from the very beginning. And then right before the Israelites left the land of Moab, the last place they camped, the Scripture tells us that in Numbers chapter 22, that some Moabite women seduced many of the Hebrew men into licentious idolatry. Now, those are hardly the kinds of things that make for lasting relationships, lasting friendships. And you can begin to see why there was so much animosity between the Israelites and the Moabites. But that wasn't the end of it. Just because the Israelites passed through their land and went on into their land, the land of Canaan, didn't mean that the problems were over. In fact, early in the time of the judges, and you can read about that in Judges chapter 3, the king of Moab was a man named Eglon. Eglon, E-G-L-O-N. And he invaded Canaan. He was still upset. They were still upset about what had happened. And so he invaded Canaan. He established the seat of government at Jericho. And he began to send out these war parties from there. And he oppressed all the people who lived around there. And that oppression continued for 18 years until finally he was assassinated. King Saul, when he became king, he warred with the Moabites during his entire reign. And then the year that Elisha the prophet died, the Bible says that bands of Moabites invaded the kingdom of Israel. I mean, you can just read about it over and over and over and over. Then even after the books of history are done, you can read in the prophets, in Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel and Amos and Zephaniah, you can read in those prophets where they denounced the Moabites as examples of enemies of the kingdom of God. You get an idea about how they just didn't like each other a whole lot? So for centuries, I mean, we're not talking about just a little spat. For centuries, the Moabites and the Hebrews had been enemies. And they hated each other with equal venom. They fought in battle every chance they got. In fact, there's hardly a time when you mention the Moabites, you find mention of the Moabites in the scriptures where they aren't up to no good, where they aren't up to any good. Excuse me. My Mississippi came out in me. If there wasn't a reason to fight and kill each other at the moment, they just made one up. Now, let's think about the religion of the Moabites. What kind of God did they worship? You may remember this from our Sunday night studies. The national god was named Chemosh. And he was worshipped by sacrificing children as burnt offerings. That's a horrible way to live. A horrible way to grow up. But that's the kind of background that Ruth, the Moabitess, had. She grew up seeing these kinds of things. But in spite of all that, now y'all don't look at him like that. Y'all did the same thing when you were little. I didn't. No, I really didn't, because I wasn't taken to church when I was little. I did my share of that other places. But in spite of all of that that we've mentioned, in spite of the fact that Ruth was a woman and a Moabite woman, in spite of the fact that the Moabites had their beginning in an incestuous relationship between father and daughter, in spite of the fact that they were heathen, in spite of the fact that the Israelites and the Moabites were always at each other's throats, God still used this Ruth to bring about His purposes and His plan. And here's the proof of what I just said. Ruth, this is the reason why we read the very end of the book. Ruth became the great grandmother of David, who was to be the greatest king that Israel ever had. But there's something else here we don't want to miss, because it reveals even more of the grace of God to us. After Ruth, chapter 1, after Ruth returned to Bethlehem with her mother-in-law Naomi, both of them widowed, Ruth was married to Boaz, a relative of Naomi. Now, what we know of Boaz from the book of Ruth is limited, but away over in the New Testament, in Matthew chapter 1, we find something very, very interesting. Matthew chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, it tells us that Boaz's mother, Ruth marries Boaz, Boaz's mother was named Rahab. Rahab, you remember her? You remember her? Remember the two spies that slipped into Jericho before the walls of the city came tumbling down? They were hidden by Rahab, and what's important here is that Rahab was known as Rahab the harlot. Almost everywhere you find her name in the scriptures, that's what she's called. So not only was the great-grandmother of David a Moabite heathen, but his great-grandfather was the son of a harlot. Now, with a background like that, most churches wouldn't even elect David to a committee. And yet, in spite of all that, in spite of their past, God still used them. He still used them. And standing on this side of the cross and looking back, we can see not only that Boaz was the father of Obed by Ruth, and Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of David the king, but if you follow that lineage all the way through, we can see even further than that, all the way to the King of Kings, Jesus Christ the Lord. So to think that Jesus, the Son of God, was a descendant of a heathen Moabite woman and a descendant of a harlot, it's not discouraging to me. That doesn't hurt my faith at all. In fact, it very much encourages me. It brings joy to my heart to know that if God included people like that in His great plan of salvation for the world, then nothing that I have done is beyond the reach of God's grace. Nothing. And I put my head on the pillow at night and my eyes pop open with the memory of some stupid thing I did years ago. Some sinful thing I allowed in my heart. All I have to do is say, that was covered. That too was covered by the blood of Christ. The grace reaches even to that. That is what the book of Ruth means to me as a follower of Christ. So no matter what's in my past, no matter what skeleton is there in my closet, I can know and experience personally the grace of God working in my life, and not just to save me from sin and hell. If I repent and seek the grace of God, I can experience that grace working in my life to give me meaning and purpose and make my life useful in His kingdom. If God can bring if God can use a heathen woman with a past like that, and if God can use the son of a harlot to bring a Savior to the world, then surely He can use me. That's what's so exciting. And when I turn to the pages of the New Testament, I find beautiful words and promises such as these. Remember Scripture? New Testament agrees with Scripture, Old Testament. Listen to this. See if you've heard this one before. For it is by grace you've been saved through faith. And that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. Or about this from Acts 15. We believe it is through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ that we are saved. And then listen to this. This is written by Paul. And you've heard these words before, but I want you to hear them in this context. From Titus chapter 3. But when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, He saved us. Not because of righteous things we have done, but because of His mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom He poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior. So that having been justified by His grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. Even us. Even us. Written by the Apostle Paul. And we read that and we say, how can he say such things? Remember that Paul had zealously persecuted the church? Remember that? He had gone into the homes of the early believers and he dragged them out. He even sent some of them to their deaths. They were executed because they were followers of Christ. And then the Lord Jesus gloriously saved him on the road to Damascus. And by the very same grace that included Ruth and Rahab in the lineage of Jesus Christ, God made Paul to be an apostle. Now, again, here's a passage you've heard before and you're familiar with it, but I want you to hear it this time in this context. 1 Timothy chapter 1, where Paul says, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that He has considered me faithful, appointing me to His service. Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying, he said, that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Did you notice that? He didn't come into the world to save rich people, socially connected people, educated people. He didn't say any of that. He didn't say he came into the world to save righteous people, perfect people, handsome, beautiful people. He came into the world to save sinners, of whom, Paul said, I am the worst. But get this. He says, I'm the worst of sinners, but for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display His unlimited power as an example for those who would believe on Him and receive eternal life. In other words, he's saying, I'm the chief of sinners. I'm the worst one there has ever been. And he gave example of that. And then he said, I am display number one. If you have any doubt, he's saying that he can save you, all you got to do is look at what he's done for me. And all we've got to do is look at what God did with Ruth. If God can save a sinner like Paul and a sinner like Ruth and a sinner like Rahab, well, let's put another R in there, a sinner like Rocky, then the message of good news for you is that He can save you too. Beyond that, God will even use you to bring glory to His name. Now, he won't use you to provide a Savior for the world, because that's already been done. But He will use you to tell the world about that Savior. And He can do it in spite of your past, in spite of your background, in spite of your limited resources. In fact, God seems to delight in choosing. In fact, the Scripture tells us this in the New Testament, that He seems to delight in choosing the weak people of the world. And the people who don't have any social standing, the people who don't really count for anything in the eyes of the world, God delights in choosing people just like that so that He can show to the world how strong He is and how mighty He is and how loving and forgiving and powerful He is. I mean, if God just saved righteous people, what hope would I have? If He just saved rich people, what hope would any of us have? If He just saved handsome people, well, about half of us in here would go. Now listen carefully to what I'm about to say. If He just saved beautiful people, then all of us in here, all the ladies would go. Did I rescue myself okay with that one? But that's not what He did. He does it because of the fact that we don't depend on our own righteousness or what we have or who we're connected to or what we look like, but on the righteousness of God, which is ours through the Lord Jesus Christ. If you're burdened by some sin in your past, something that just weighs you down, today you can know the forgiveness and fresh start that a life in Christ will offer you. If you're plagued by some doubt and you think God can't use you because of your age or your health or some other perceived inability of yours, then you can know the joy of being useful and productive in God's kingdom, because you're not a mess up. You think God can't use you? Think again. Everything we read in the Scriptures says differently. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to You now to thank You so much, Lord, for all that You've done. Lord, we read the book of Ruth, and we read it in light of the New Testament. We read it beyond just what the words in Ruth say. We compare Scripture with Scripture, and we see, Lord, that You really outdid Yourself. You reached down and chose someone. On purpose, You chose someone like her. to get the message of grace and mercy out there to the world. And all these long years later, it resonates even in our hearts. We see what you did with her, and we see what you did with Rahab, and we see what you did with Paul, and we look around us and we see what you're doing with people that we know. And Lord, it shows us that you can do things with us too. It encourages us, Lord. But if there's somebody here today, maybe they're already a believer, but they've been holding back because there's something in their past that's weighing them down. They've never really forgiven themselves. Maybe they've never asked for your forgiveness. I pray, Lord, that today they'll find that freedom from knowing that the blood of Jesus Christ and the forgiveness that He offers because of it extends even to that thing. Even if the whole world knows about it. And Lord, there may be even somebody here today who doesn't even know you. And maybe they've been holding back because they think because of what they've done, you could never forgive them. You couldn't possibly want them. I pray that the gospel of grace that we've heard today from Ruth will change that perception altogether. And they will come to you as we stand, Lord, that they will come to you in joyful abandon, giving themselves to you. And Lord, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, you've heard the prayer. You stand. You've heard the prayer. You know what this is about. You come. Don't wait another second. You come now.
I've waited 2 weeks to be able to say this. One hand for yourself and one hand for somebody else. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Love you. See you tonight.